Amid the political crisis in Rajasthan, Ashok Gehlot continues to push for an assembly session after a cabinet meeting at his residence on Saturday. Congress has decided to take the battle against the governor to the streets. Sources tell CNN News 18 that Gehlot has urged the governor to approve the assembly session from July 31st. He has also responded to the governor's 6 queries, saying that as per the constitution, he was duty-bound to listen to the advice of the state government. Congress has accused the governor of employing delaying tactics under pressure from the BJP government at the center, while the BJP has accused Gehlot of threatening the governor. Here's a ground report from Bhavani Deora, summing up the latest developments in the Rajasthan political war.
Rajasthan ke Raj Bhavan mein aaj din bhar suraksha ghera lagta raha aur hatta raha. Lag is umeed mein raha कि मुख्यमंत्री आने वाले, बार बार ये मैसेज आया कि मुख्यमंत्री आने वाले, और जैसे ही सुरक्षा बढ़ाई कुछ देर बाद में फिर हटा लिया. लेकिन जो हमारी जानकारी के मुताबिक मुख्यमंत्री की ओर से कोई समय राजभवन से नहीं मांगा गया, इसके बावजूद भी ये तैयारियां बार बार दिख रही है. अभी आप देख सकते हैं तस्वीरों में सुरक्षा घेरा कड़ा था कि मुख्यमंत्री पहुँचने वाले हैं, और अब सुरक्षा हटाई जा रही है, यानी कि मुख्यमंत्री नहीं आने वाले. यही सस्पेंस सरकार का बना हुआ है, यही सस्पेंस विधानसभा सत्र को लेकर बना हुआ है कि विधानसभा सत्र का क्या होगा. प्रपोजल, जिस प्रपोजल की बात की जा रही, वो अभी तक राजभवन तक नहीं पहुंचा, जिसके लिए कल मुख्यमंत्री अशोक गहलोत ने अपने विधायकों के साथ राजभवन के अंदर धरना दिया था, नारेबाजी की थी.
Joined by Pallavi Ghosh, who tracks the Congress. Pallavi, good morning. Yesterday's protest, Ashok Gehlot said he was going to take the protest statewide, and it was quite underwhelming. Is this a renewed pitch to now take this this competition with the governor nationwide?
Yes, today onwards, there's going to be an online campaign with a Congress media cell and a social media cell is going to unleash. So online, essentially, they're going to take pot shots at the governor, but more importantly, at the central government, saying that they are dictating these delaying tactics and a defiance of the constitution, which actually demands that the governor calls an assembly session whenever the chief minister advises it. But from Monday, and that's also incidentally the day when the Supreme Court is going to begin its hearing on the petition by the Congress party on behalf of the Speaker, as well as Sachin Pilot's petition, we are going to be seeing, you know, what they are called the sit-ins outside the Raj Bhavan, essentially to make the point that the Raj Bhavan has also now become a den of politics. No delaying tactics should be allowed. Under Article 174, the governor has to go by the advice of the chief minister, since the cabinet has already recommended it. And now Ashok Gehlot is demanding that by the end of next week, an assembly session should be called, by which time a decision should have been taken by the Supreme Court as well.
Thanks for that update, Pallavi. We'll continue to track the Rajasthan political crisis as it develops. Now, leader of the opposition in the Rajasthan Assembly, Gulab Singh Kataria, says Ashok Gehlot has crossed all limits and must resign for threatening the governor.
हमारे साथ हैं गुलाब सिंह कटारिया, विपक्षी नेता. सर, ये बताएं, क्या आपने क्या मांग की है?
हमने यही मांगी है कि वो जिस तरह से दबाव की राजनीति से महामहिम को जिस ढंग से उन्होंने व्यवहार किया, वो बिल्कुल निंदनीय व्यवहार है, और इसके लिए आप निश्चित रूप से जो आज धरने दिए हैं, वो भी एक तरह से पब्लिक में ये प्रेशर बनाने के लिए दिया है कि आप विधानसभा का सत्र बुलाओ. विधानसभा का सत्र, उन्होंने जो 6 प्रश्न लिख के दिए, उसका जवाब दो, कानून की दृष्टि से पूर्ति करो. आपका जो संवैधानिक अधिकार है, उसको कोई चैलेंज नहीं कर रहा है, पर अधिकार जिन सीमाओं में है उसका भी तो पालन करो.
अच्छा, क्या आपने त्यागपत्र की बात कर रहे थे कि मुख्यमंत्री
त्याग? मैं तो आपके सामने जिस प्रकार का उसने कहा ना कि यहाँ क्या कानून व्यवस्था होगी, ये मेरी जिम्मेदारी नहीं होगी, तो फिर राजस्थान के मुख्यमंत्री और गृह मंत्री की नहीं होगी तो क्या भगवान की होगी? इसलिए मैंने
जवाब दे दिया.
मैंने जो केंद्र का जो है वो CRPF बुलाने के लिए कहा, इसलिए कहा कि सुरक्षित करने के लिए, इसके अलावा फिर कोई चारा नहीं.
कोई संवैधानिक संकट देख रहे हैं आप?
निश्चित रूप से जो व्यवहार करे वो तो संवैधानिक संकट का रूप आ गया.
मुख्यमंत्री का कहना है कि अब अगर सिफारिश मंत्रिमंडल से की जाती है और दूसरी बार की जाती है तो राज्यपाल लौटा नहीं सकते हैं, ये तो अधिकार उनके पास है ही नहीं.
अब उन्होंने कारण दिया कि मैं बहुमत सिद्ध करना चाहता हूँ. बहुमत तो उनके पास, वो खुद कहते हैं बहुमत है, तो फिर सिद्ध क्या करना उनको? बहुमत है, अपनी सरकार को चलाओ ना. देखिए, भारतीय जनता पार्टी अभी एक जागरूक राजनीतिक दर्शक के रूप में सारे इस हाई प्रोफाइल पॉलिटिकल ड्रामे को देख रही है, और हमें जहां आवश्यकता पड़ेगी हम तिल भी देखेंगे, तिल की धार को भी देखेंगे, उसके बाद देखेंगे।
क्या सचिन पायलट मुख्यमंत्री बन सकते हैं?
मैं इसके बारे में कोई टिप्पणी नहीं कर सकता। मुख्यमंत्री कोई भी बन सकता है अगर इस डेमोक्रेसी में अगर उसको विधायकों का बहुमत मिलता है तो।
आप एक संवैधानिक पद जो गवर्नर साहब का है, आप उनके घर पर आते हैं और उन्हें आतंकित करते हैं, मतलब कमाल की बात है। आप उनको आतंकित करते हैं, आप उनको धमकी देते हैं कि आपकी सिक्योरिटी अब हम नहीं संभाल पाएंगे, आप देख लीजिए। ये कहाँ की ये राजनीति को आज इस स्तर पर लेकर आ गए? हम आज गवर्नर साहब को आकर हमने यही कहा कि आप इस बात का संज्ञान लीजिए इन सभी चीज़ों का।
बहुमत साबित करना चाहती सरकार, तो उसमें परेशानी क्या है? बहुमत साबित करना चाहती, उनको मौका मिलना चाहिए ना।
बहुमत साबित जरूर करें अगर उसकी ज़रूरत उन्हें लगती है तो। हमें तो स्पष्ट यह है कि बहुमत उनके पास नहीं है, क्योंकि अगर होता तो लोगों को पिछले 15-20 दिनों से बंद करने की क्या ज़रूरत पड़ी थी विधायकों को।
कोरोना के संक्रमण का बार बार ये हवाला देते हैं, लेकिन आज जिस तरीके से राजस्थान में धरने हुए सत्ताधारी दल के लोगों के द्वारा किस तरीके से धज्जियां उड़ाई गई और इस पर एतराज था, ये बात हमने महामहिम को कही।
आप खुद भी कह रहे थे बीजेपी की अल्पमत में सरकार, तो फिर सदन सेशन बुलाने में क्या दिक्कत है? बहुमत साबित
नहीं, हम कहाँ कह रहे हैं सेशन मत बुलाओ, हम ये कह ही नहीं रहे। सेशन बुलाना महामहिम का अधिकार है, उसका एक विधिवत नोटिस जाता है, 21 दिन की परंपरा है, सारी व्यवस्थाएं विधानसभा के नियमों में संविधान में उल्लिखित हैं। हम कहाँ मना कर रहे हैं? हम तो ये कहा था कि इस तरीके से आप फोर्स नहीं कर सकते संविधानिक संस्था के अध्यक्ष को कि आप ये कह रहे हो कि यहाँ 8 करोड़ लोग राजभवन को घेर लेंगे।
अच्छा, क्या राष्ट्रपति शासन की डिमांड की आपने?
हमने नहीं करी, आवश्यकता भी नहीं है, वो तो परिस्थितियाँ तय करेंगी कब क्या होगा, लेकिन हमने अपनी तरफ से इस तरीके कोई डिमांड नहीं की।
India is celebrating the 21st Kargil Vijay Diwas today. It was on this day that the Kargil War formally came to an end, with Indian soldiers successfully recapturing mountain heights that had been seized by Pakistan. In view of the COVID-19 pandemic, celebrations would be muted this year, with just wreath-laying ceremonies at war memorials in Kargil's Dras and the national capital. Let's take a look at some of the rare visuals of our war heroes hoisting India's flag at the height of 16,000 feet in the Mushko Valley after one of the most defining battles of the Kargil War.
Of the many battles that defined the Kargil War, the one for .4875 was perhaps the toughest. This rare footage of the war shows soldiers of 13 Jammu and Kashmir Rifles planting India's flag at a height of 16,000 feet in the Mushko Valley. The bravest of the brave regiment was led into battle by Colonel Y.K. Joshi.
This feature was captured on the 5th of this month. We launched attack on the 4th. This importance of point.
A battle that forged heroes like Captain Vikram Batra and Captain Anuj Nayyar. In the summer of 1999, Pakistani intruders had captured several mountain tops, including .4875, overlooking the strategic Srinagar-Leh highway, with the enemy sitting at the top, raining bullets and boulders. India's offensive had become an uphill battle. Clearing .4875 had become priority. The task was given to 13 Jammu and Kashmir Rifles. On 6th and 7th of July, Captain Batra volunteered to head a party to clear a crucial ledge on .4875. The climb was almost vertical. It began to snow. The enemy kept firing from the top. To make matters worse, Captain Batra was running a high fever. Yet, he and his troops kept climbing through the night. As they closed onto the ledge, the enemy was now eyeball to eyeball. The fight became hand to hand. Captain Batra, all of 24, killed 5 enemy soldiers and, despite being injured, led from the front. kept the attack on and did the near impossible. On 8th morning, 0.4875 was recaptured, but 13 Jammu and Kashmir Rifle had lost their Sher Shah. The young Indian soldier who fought ferociously, died fearlessly, and became the face of the Kargil War. Today, 0.4875 is called Batra Top. 20 years after Captain Vikram Batra and 13 Jammu and Kashmir Rifle entered the annals of India's military history, his unit made a pilgrimage back to Batra Top, led by Lieutenant General Y.K. Joshi.
Durga Mata Ki Jai!
Jai Ki Jai! Ki Jai! Ki Jai!
Now, speaking exclusively to CNN News 18, Northern Command Chief Lieutenant General Y.K. Joshi described how Indian soldiers successfully recaptured the mountain heights that had been seized by Pakistan in 1999. He also said that it can't be compared to the LSE situation, as India is a more capable and modern army that will continue to defend the nation's territory.
21 years ago, in the heights of Kargil, in the middle of a raging conflict, you took over the command of 13 Jammu and Kashmir Rifles. Today, you are the Northern Army commander, the guardians of these very heights. When you look back, do you feel a sense of loss or a sense of pride?
Well, Shreya, those were challenging times. And as battalion commander, it was an honor for me to lead the finest troops into battle. You know, it's a dream which every officer harbors, and it came true for me. I look back at those days, you know, with a sense of reverence and gratitude to the men who made the supreme sacrifice for the country. It was my duty then to recapture those features, and it is my duty now to ensure the sanctity. Putting into perspective, you know, the canvas has expanded exponentially, and I'm humbled by the responsibility the nation and the Indian Army has entrusted to me. It's a difficult task, and I'm aware of the challenges which Northern Command faces. Loss and pride are emotions which are, you know, very minuscule compared to emotions like accountability and responsibility, which are key to my charter of duties. It is my responsibility to ensure sanctity of the borders. At the same time, I am accountable for the well-being of troops who are braving the elements stoically and ensuring the territorial integrity of the nation and also ensuring peace in the hinterland.
Sir, would you say the standoff at the LAC is the biggest challenge of your professional life, or would that be Kargil?
Well, Shreya, I think that would be like something like comparing apples to oranges. You know, the challenge of Kargil and the present situation are in a totally different domain. And for me to pick one would not be right. You know, each situation has its own peculiarities. Just for the sake of taking the argument further, you know, my mandate then and now cannot be compared. You know, we are more capable and modern army with better weapon systems and equipment at our disposal. And these are game changers. You know, as a professional soldier, one grows and accumulates the capabilities to discharge the duties, you know, entrusted. Yes, 0.4875 was a challenge then, in the given circumstances, and the line of actual control on Eastern Ladakh today is a challenge. You know, we as an organization concluded that situation in 1999 to our satisfaction then. And so would be in this case too.
As the nation celebrates the Kargil warriors, with the Indian Air Force has released a tribute video to salute our brave martyrs.
Hum shant chahte hain, ye to duniya ne dekha. अब दुनिया ये देखेगी कि हम शांति की रक्षा के लिए और अपनी शक्ति का भी प्रदर्शन कर सकते हैं. लड़ाई के परिणाम के बारे में भी मेरे मन में कोई संदेह नहीं है. हमारी विजय निश्चित है और हम विजयी होकर दिखाएंगे.
The nation stands united in saluting the Kargil warriors. Now, shifting focus to the COVID pandemic. Since the beginning of the pandemic, children have been spared from the worst health impacts of COVID-19. Now, doctors at Mumbai's Wadia Hospital for Children have flagged concerns, saying children too are showing symptoms of the life-threatening illness. Mihir Trivedi gets us this report.
Parents across the world have taken heart from data which suggests children are not severely affected by COVID. But doctors at Mumbai's Wadia Hospital for Children beg to differ. 18 of the 650 children they treated for COVID have developed a potentially life-threatening illness, pediatric multisystem inflammatory syndrome. Similar to Kawasaki disease, its symptoms include a persistent fever, rash, and inflammation, eventually leading to multi-organ failure. The hospital recently lost one of its patients to PMIS, a 4.5-year-old girl child who succumbed to the deadly disease within 6 hours of admission.
It has been reported in adults as a multisystem inflammatory syndrome. This is hardly reported in literature of pediatric affection. And we started seeing those children with skin rash and, you know, heart getting affected and the liver getting affected, and these children coming in a state of shock.
PMIS affects children between the ages of 10 months to 15 years. Findings suggest that PMIS can develop even 3 to 4 weeks after exposure to COVID. In severe cases, the inflammation spreads to blood vessels, particularly around the heart, which can be fatal.
Amongst these 18 children, we had one of the child who had the heart which was, you know, very different, what we call as broken heart syndrome. It's called as Takotsubo disease, which has been described early in adults in late 1990s. So in children, it is not described in literature at all. Fortunately, as we were aware of the disease, we could, you know, give her the medications, and she is now on the road to recovery.
Wadia Hospital is one of 4 hospitals which are part of a larger study researching the link between COVID-19 and PMIS. Wadia says it has significant evidence of the link.
The findings which we have got is out of 118. So our research team is expecting to see a greater sample size and then, you know, conclude the findings. We could come to a conclusion very soon on these findings and how the disease proceeds ahead and the prognosis of these children.
A large study seeking to understand the link between COVID-19 and PMIS is underway. The report of this finding will be shared with the ICMR soon. The study will also help in treating such cases in a much more informed way. With video journalist C.S. Rajesh, in Mumbai, this is Mihir Trivedi.
Nearly 10 lakh people have been affected by the floods in Bihar. Over 10 lakh people have been affected due to the floods in the state. Nearly 16,000 people are temporarily living in shelters. 22 teams of the NDRF and SDRF have been deployed in the state across 10 districts. The turbulent Gandak River breached the embankment at a village in the Sangrampur block of the East Champaran district yesterday due to incessant downpour and heavy discharge of water into the river Darbhanga continues to be the worst hit district in the state, where the deluge has affected over 3 lakh people. Now, torrential rains and overflow of the Valmiki Nagar barrage in Bihar's Gopalganj district has resulted in heavy flooding. Chandra Mohan brings us this report.
Valmiki Nagar barrage se 4,38,000 cubic pani discharge hone ke baad Gopalganj ke Devapur ilake mein baadh se halaat bigadne lage hain aur tasveeron mein bhi aap saaf taur par dekh sakte hain is ilake mein kahin 12 feet तो कहीं 15 फीट तक पानी चला गया है, जिसके बाद इस इलाके में फंसे हुए लोग किसी तरह से बाहर निकलने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं। आप हमको ही देख लीजिए, सीना तक पानी है, और अगर हम इसके दाएं जाएं या फिर बाएं जाएं, दोनों तरफ 12 फीट से ज़्यादा पानी है, और ऐसे में अगर पैर फिसला तो हम कहाँ जाएंगे, महज आप अंदाज़ा लगा सकते हैं। और सामने जो गाँव है, इस गाँव में फर्स्ट फ्लोर तक पानी चला गया है, जिसके बाद जो इलाके में फंसे हैं वो बाहर नहीं निकल पा रहे हैं, और जो बाहर हैं वो अंदर नहीं जा पा रहे हैं। ऐसे में इस इलाके के लोग किस हालात में रहते हैं आप महज अंदाजा लगा सकते हैं। ये बताइए, घर में तो पानी चला गया है तो फिर कैसे आप लोग रहते हैं?
क्या करें सर, कोई साधन यहाँ नहीं है, कुछ भी यहाँ नहीं, कोई आते हैं नहीं कोई जाते हैं, हम लोग इधर के इधर फंसे हुए हैं, इधर से इधर फंसे हुए हैं, कोई साधन हम लोग का नहीं मिल रहा है सर।
इस वक्त हम मौजूद है सिवान के दहा नदी पे, आप देख सकते हैं पूरी तरह से दहा नदी उफान पे है, जहां गोपालगंज में सारी नदियां उफान पे है, और ये भी नदी आप देख सकते हैं, ये दहा नदी है सिवान का जो काफ़ी उफान पे है, काफ़ी तेज धारा आप देख सकते हैं, यानी पहले यहां सूखा था और अब जब बारिश की पानी लगातार हो रही है, वहीं जो नेपाल से बराज की पानी छोड़ी गई है तो उसको लेकर दहा नदी उफान पे है। लोग अपने घर में है, बाहर बहुत कम निकल रहे हैं, क्योंकि पहले यहाँ इस घाट पे शाम के समय में एक भीड़ लगा रहता था, वो अब देखने को नहीं मिल रहा है।
Floods also continue to wreak havoc in Assam. The death toll now touches 97. Nearly 28 lakh people across 26 districts in the state have been affected. Relief and rescue operations are currently underway with over 50,000 people in 300 relief camps. Floods continue to affect Kaziranga National Park and Tiger Reserve with almost 85% of the area completely inundated. Over 125 animals in the park, including 13 rhinos, have died. A dual battle against the pandemic and floods. You can catch all those stories on news18.com. Stay healthy, stay safe.